araw, ang susunod naman nating pag-aaralan ay tungkol sa tinatawag na theoretical framework. So, from the name itself, theoretical theory, we are going to talk about theory. But before that, let us define, what is theory? Theory is a body of knowledge developed by researchers trying to explain a phenomena, draw connections, and make predictions. Para bang yung theory of evolution ni Charles Darwin na sinasabing tayong mga present species ay nanggaling at nagmula sa tinatawag na primitive form. Kumbaga, nag-evolve tayo mula sa dati nating itsura papunta sa itsura natin sa ngayon. Halimbawa, yung mga tao, nanggaling daw tayo sa mga apes na kung saan ipinapaliwanag nito yung phenomena. Saan ba tayo nanggaling? Saan ba tayo nagmula? And from that, it draws connection sa pagitan ng mga unggoy at ng mga tao. Ano bang pagkakapareho natin sa mga unggoy? Paano nangyari na nasabi na tayong mga tao ay possibly nag-evolve mula sa mga unggoy? Ano ba ang meron tong mga to na meron din tayo? And finally is to make predictions. Ipagpalagay natin na totoong nanggaling tayo sa unggoy. Therefore, after hundreds of years, thousands of years, unti-unti tayong nag-evolve papunta sa kung ano tayo ngayon. Pero hindi nagtatapos ang evolution. Ibig sabihin, kung ano man ang itsura natin ngayong mga tao, hindi ito yung tinatawag na ultimate form. We are still undergoing evolution. Who can tell ano ang magiging itsura natin hundreds of years from now, thousands of years from now, millions of years from now? Again, that is guided by the theory of evolution. Therefore, theory is an important element of research wherein it guides our research in the process. It gives us the tendency, it gives us the idea, ano ba ang nangyayari o ano ba ang pwedeng mangyayari. Especially sa mga social research na kung saan involve yung mga tao. Alam naman natin ang mga tao may individual differences, magkakaiba ng iniisip, magkakaiba ng talino, magkakaiba ng emosyon, magkakaiba ng consideration. Ibig sabihin, hindi tayo pare-pareho. But using theory, it can highly explain what is happening. Again, that is theory. While the word framework means structure, a logical structure. Ibig sabihin, may tamang pagkakasunod-sunod. Therefore, theoretical framework is a structure that trying to define the key concept in your research which proposes relationship between them and discusses relevant ideas based on the literature review. Tama ka, literature review. Sa madaling salita, bago ka makakuha ng theory na sa palagay mo ay suwak sa study mo, you have to read the literature review. The main goal of theoretical framework is it to provides a particular perspective or lens through which to examine a topic. Tandaan mo, hindi ikaw yung nauna sa topic na pinili mo. Marami nang nauna sa'yo. Ibig sabihin, itong mga study na nauna sa'yo, they already establish facts or information from their study. Therefore, by reading this literature, you are guided already sa mga possible na mangyayari sa study mo since your study and their study are related. That's why it gives you the perspective. That's why it gives you the idea. Para siyang mapa, ginaguide ka niya sa dapat mong puntahan. Isipin mo na lang kung wala kang mapa. Alam mo ba kung saan ka pupunta? Siyempre hindi. That's why importante ang theoretical framework. Ang susunod natin pag-uusapan is on how to create theoretical framework. The first thing that you are going to consider is identify your key concept. In every research, there is a key concept. Pag sinabi natin key concept, that is the main variable. That is our main concern. Ano ba yung variable na nag-play sa research mo? Therefore, yan yung i-consider mo sa paghahanap na appropriate theory na gagamitin mo sa study mo. The second one is to evaluate and explain relevant theories. Tandaan, Possible kasi na itong key concept na napili mo sa study mo ay maraming theory na nagpapaliwanag tungkol dyan. For example, pain, stress, depression, anxiety, life expectancy. Yung mga topic na yon, napakaraming theory na sumusubok magpaliwanag bakit sila nangyayari. Therefore, for the second step, you have to evaluate every theories na makikita mong related sa key concept na pinili mo. Ibig sabihin, you are going to screen out. Tatanggalin mo yung mga theories na sa palagay mo ay hindi swak para sa study mo. Then finally, you are going to justify. Let's say nahanap mo na yung theory na para sa yon, yung sa palagay mo swak sa ginagawa mo. Or you are going to justify how this theory will guide your research as well as how your research fits in this theory. Siyempre, kailangan may justification para makita natin kung talaga bang tama yung theory na pinili mo. Para bigyan linaw yung mga sinasabi ko kanina, bibigyan ko kayo ng mga example. The first one, our research title is the levels of English speaking anxiety among call center trainees in the workplace. Ano sa palagay nyo yung key concept sa research title na to? Tama ka. Ang key concept natin dito is the English speaking anxiety. Therefore, yan yung main word na i-consider natin sa paghahanap ng ating theory. Pero ang tanong, sapat na ba yun? Kasi kung iisipin mo mabuti, kung English speaking anxiety lang ang consideration mo, maraming theory na pasok dyan. Ano ang makakatulong sa'yo para nang sa ganun ay man-narrow down mo, ma-boil down mo yung mga pagpipilian? Parang babae yan na naghahanap ng mapapangasawa. Kung ang kanyang basis, kung ang kanyang standard ay lalaki, ibig sabihin, marami. There are 3.5 billion na lalaki sa mundo. Marami masyado pagpipilian. Therefore, she have to add criteria, she have to add parameter in order for her to narrow down the choices. Para nang sa ganun, makahanap siya ng lalaking pasok sa panlasa niya. Ganun din sa theoretical framework. We have to set criteria, we have to set parameters in order for us to narrow down, to identify, to specify the theory that we are looking for. Let us dig deep on our research title. And one of the ways is for us to define what is the problem all about. And here is the problem. Employees are in the circumstance of speaking anxiety in English language. Consequently, this very reason led them to avoid speaking with foreigners. Kitang-kita nyo naman na mga empleyado pala ay merong tinatawag na speaking anxiety, especially kapag kailangan nila makapag-communicate in English language, particularly if they are speaking with foreigners. At this point, we can list some terms that might help us to further identify the theory that is appropriate in our study. And at this point, I would like to jot down the word foreigners. Again, we have to set another criteria, and that is the objective. The objective is to assess the level of English speaking anxiety among call center trainees. And in order for us to attain this objective, we have to answer the following research question. What are the factors affecting English speaking anxiety among trainees? What are the levels of English speaking anxiety among trainees in terms of age, sex, and educational attainment? So kung mapapansin nyo mabuti, under English speaking anxiety, we are identifying the factors. So therefore, one of the additional concepts that we might include in our research is the factors. Another thing is the demographics. How this English speaking anxiety is related, is connected to our demographic profile. Therefore, these additional concepts, the foreigners, the factors, the demographics, might help us to narrow down, to identify the appropriate theory that we are looking for in our study. After identifying all the parameters that might help us, it is now in order to identify the key concept. Again, the key concept is English speaking anxiety. And based on literature review, again, everything must be based on a literature review. Proficiency in language speaking has been one of the most indispensable skills an office employee must possess for him or her to continue longer in his or her tenure by night 2015. So malinaw na ang pagiging proficient sa pagsasalita ay isa sa mga skill set na kailangan ng isang empleyado para nang sa ganun ay magtagal siya at maging competent siya sa trabaho niya. With this known fact, many opportunity seekers still struggle in keeping up with the requirements, particularly in telecommunication and call center industries, where foreign language speaking proficiencies are on top of their skill sets. Yan, kitang-kita na isa sa mga pinakahinahanap pagdating sa trabaho is your skill on how are you going to communicate with others, particularly with your client, which is foreign-based client. You have to speak in foreign language in order for you to cope up with the demand of your job, which I think contributes to sa tinatawag na English speaking anxiety. Since tayo mga Pilipino, ang ating mother tongue ay Filipino language, we are not used to, hindi natin araw-araw na ginagamit o sinasalita ang English. Therefore, there's a good chance na hindi natin siya well-versed. It is by true practice na kung saan napapractice natin yung pagsasalita ng English. But still, iba pa rin yun sa talagang ang lingwahe nila ay English. Therefore, dito na pumapasok yung ating chosen theory about English anxiety, and that is Foreign Language Anxiety Theory by Horwitz, Horwitz and Cope in 1986. This theory affirms that language anxiety is composed of and a combination of the following components: communication apprehension, test anxiety, and fear of negative evaluation. Kung mapapansin nyo mabuti, yung communication apprehension, yung test anxiety, and the fear of negative evaluation, those are the factors that contributes to English speaking anxiety of a particular person. Therefore, kung mapapansin nyo, unang-una yung word na foreign, paralel siya doon sa ating key concept at doon sa additional concept. Secondly, yung mga component, yung mga factors ay parallel naman dun sa research problem na pinresent natin kanina. At kapag nag-dig deep tayo dito sa mga factors na to, it will eventually related to our demographics. For example, communication apprehension. Habang nakikipag-usap ka, nagkakaroon ka ng certain anxiety na para bang pakiramdam mo dahil Filipino ka, hindi mo first language ang English at ang kausap mo ay Amerikano na kung saan yun ang talagang lingwahe niya, nagkakaroon ka ng pag-aalala or nagkakaroon ka ng anxiety na pakiramdam mo, hinuhusgahan ka ng kausap mo. That contributes to your fear in speaking in English or in speaking in foreign language. Test anxiety. Habang nagte-test ka tapos yung test mo is in English language, by concept, alam mo yung pinag-aralan mo. Pero dahil yung test ay in English, nagkakaroon ka ng anxiety na naapektuhan nun kung paano ka mag-isip. And finally, the fear of negative evaluation. Tandaan natin that in this study, call center trainees are employees, and once they speak with their clients, they are being evaluated. Therefore, meron silang takot sa likod ng utak nila, meron silang takot na bibigyan sila ng negative evaluation ng client nila. Kasi nga, maybe they found themselves incompetent, they found themselves lacking sa pagsasalita ng English. Actually, hindi lang din ibang tao ang pwede magbigay sa iyo ng negative evaluation. Maging ang sarili mo. Ang utak natin, minsan hindi pa natin nasusubukan Sinasabi na natin, hindi ko kaya, hindi ko kaya. Why? Because you are giving a negative evaluation sa sarili mo. You underestimated yung kakayahan mo bago mo pa siya i-apply. So those factors are the contributors ng tinatawag nating foreign language theory. And I hope malinaw sa inyo yun. So as to better understand the relationship of these factors to the theory, we have this model. So kung makikita nyo mabuti, these factors determine your level of foreign language anxiety, which tries to explain yung ating chosen research title. So as for the second example, is the prevalence of type 2 diabetes among the teachers of Flo Hills Memorial National High School. Again, the first step is for us to identify the key concept. What is the key concept? The key concept here is the diabetes. It gives us the main idea of the study. Again, hindi sapat na yung main idea natin, yun lang ang gagamitin natin sa paghahanap ng ating theory. We must set additional concepts in order for us to better understand ano ba yung theory na SWAC para sa study natin. So again, we are going to identify the problem presented in that research title. And the problem is, teachers working in mentally tiring environment are found to have increase of developing type 2 diabetes according to a new study. So yun yung problema, na karamihan pala sa mga teacher na nagtatrabaho sa mentally tiring, sa stressful environment, they have this tendency to develop a type 2 diabetes. That is the problem. Now, what is the objective of the study? The objective of this study is to determine the prevalence of type 2 diabetes among the teachers at Low Hills Memorial National High School. And in order to attain this objective, we have to answer the following sub-questions. How does the study describe the respondents' physical attributes in relation to the prevalence of Low Hills Memorial National High School teachers to type 2 diabetes? And the second one, is there a significant relationship between the prevalence of type 2 diabetes risk and the respondents' demographics? So kung mapapansin nyo, nadagdag sa additional concept natin yung mentally tiring environment as well as yung physical attribute. And we are hoping at some point that this additional concept might help us to better understand, to better identify the appropriate theories for our study. Again, we already identified our key concepts, so therefore at this point we have to review the literature. Diabetes mellitus, or simply known as diabetes, it is an incurable lifelong condition in which a body has complication in producing a hormone named insulin. Insulin helps break down sugar and carbohydrates into a simpler sugar called glucose that supplies energy throughout a body system. Type 2 diabetes was once known as adult onset or non-insulin dependent diabetes. It is a type of diabetes in which it affects how the body metabolizes sugar, or also known as glucose, according to Danziger 2017. Furthermore, according to Mayo Clinic 2018, factors that increase the risk of having type 2 diabetes include age, family history, fat distribution, gestational diabetes, inactivity, polycystic ovarian syndrome, pre-diabetes, and weight. So malinaw na by literature review, type 2 diabetes is related to our physical attributes as defined in our research problem. At this point, we can say that our research problem is parallel to the literature review about type 2 diabetes. Kung mapapansin nyo, type 2 diabetes is affected by demographics such as age and family history, as well as the physical attributes such as weight. So ibig sabihin, at this point, makikita na natin yung parallelism ng literature review sa ating research question. Now, if the theory itself, our chosen theory will be homeostatic theory of obesity by Mark 2015. Let us define homeostasis. It is defined as to have an ability to keep body environment under control and keeps the condition precise for cells to live and function. Without homeostasis, body will not function properly, resulting into poor health of a human. Kung mapapansin nyo, ang sabi rito, homeostasis is defined as the ability to keep our body environment under control, which violates yung ating unang additional concept, which is teachers are experiencing mentally tiring environment. Pag sinabi mo mentally tiring environment, everything is out of control. Therefore, homeostasis is not attained by teachers because of its stressful workplace. Therefore, this theory is appropriate for our study because it clearly addresses the key concept, the additional concept being drawn by our research topic. Homeostasis imbalances lead the high number of obesity and overweight incidence of disease such as diabetes, metabolic syndrome, and cancers. So, ayan na. But again, we have to make sure that our study is connected, fits in this theory, and we have to explain how this theory fits in our study. You have to justify for that. And this is the homeostatic theory of obesity model. And as finale, always remember that a strong theoretical framework gives your research direction, allowing you to convincingly interpret, explain, and generalize from your findings. And always remember that whatever you do, especially in theoretical framework, it must be based on a literature review. Sana ay marami kayong natutunan sa lesson natin sa araw na ito. Maraming salamat.